Can you tell just by looking where a character in a film comes from? Or do you wait until you hear their voice and then go, that accent's wrong? Well, my PhD examines representations and performances of national identity, in my case, that of Scotland and the Scottish people, across the transition from silent to sound cinema, 1927 to 1933. So let's start with a silent film. Imagine a silent film for me. There are three men on the screen. How do you know which one's Scottish? He's the guy in the kilt. The kilt has been used as a readily available signifier of nationality and identity in cinema since 1897. But then sound comes in and we can consider how the voice is used and the accuracy of accents in performance. Now these two fellas, Harry Lauder and Will Fyfe, were both well-known music hall artists. The films that survive from the period I'm looking at are essentially recreations of their stage routines, okay? We can clearly see that they are both self-identifying through costume. They're wearing kilt and tartan, but there are marked differences in their performances. Fyfe uses his own accent. He delivers his routines in English, and through his performance, his Scottishness is realized. Lauder, on the other hand, imitates a Scottish Highland accent and freely and frequently uses Scots terms in order to emphasize his Scottishness. Now, the problem here is that Lauder, as my PhD shows, was the most famous Scotsman in the world at the time and was regarded globally as the quintessential Scotsman. But these are individual performers. What about ensemble pieces or narrative-driven film? Well, in 1930, a film called The Loves of Robert Burns was released. The film's in Scots dialect throughout and features a mixture of Scottish and English actors all playing Scottish roles. Using phonetic analysis, I can show that the level of accuracy across the accents throughout the entire film is actually quite high, but it was completely panned by the critics. They said it was unintelligible to English ears. And all the film was doing was attempting to be as realistic as it could be in its representation of voice. Clearly, realism has no place in entertainment that includes Harry Lauder. So, as far as tracing the development of the performance of Scottish identity through the transitional years is concerned, the problem is it was already set in the minds of the world. Lauder was too strong. Thank you. That threw me. Lauder was too strong, okay? He was already there. He was Scotland. There is currently a call for filmic representations of Scottishness to be reappraised or in some cases examined for the first time, in order that their place in the cultural makeup of the nation can be fully appreciated. My PhD supports this and shows that by looking at a wider, broader base of performers, we can actually see how national identity can be traced across the formative years of sound cinema.